That has started.
Aye. It has begun.
It's going to be hard to get the energy levels up in such comfy seats, man.
It really is. Just two lads with a couple of beers.
Couple of lads.
A couple of couches.
Likely lads.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And it's great to be British.
It's great to be British.
David's not here this week.
David is not here. He had a horrible garden accident.
Yeah. He tried to trim his hair with a strimmer.
Yep. It's pretty grim.
David is on family duties, a little bit of a medical situation, and, you know, best wishes. Sure, it'll be fine. But we are going to postpone the Public Enemy episode, and we decided this is probably a pretty good way to advertise the sort of things you get if you're a subscriber. So we do a thing called Split 7 Inches, which is not about 7 inches. So please stop sending in recommendations of great Split 7 inch records. Maybe one day, just to be fucking awkward, we will do a Split 7 inch, Split 7 inch. But the Split 7 inch is merely a metaphor for the fact that we each take a turn to have our, you know, our bit on a random topic, ideally suggested by you folks. This week we've done one that was suggested and one of our own. And if you subscribe to any level, whether it's regular, whether it's a one-off, whether it's 1,000 guineas or one single penny, you will get access to the bonus material. And it tends to be a bit more off the cuff, maybe slightly funnier, a lot less notes on my part. So
none on my part, as it would happen today.
So if you feel like paying something to our podcast, which would be really greatly appreciated because it will let us make it better. And it'll let us try some other stuff out, maybe some video stuff at some point. We would love to be able to devote more time to it, and you guys contributing will allow us to devote more time to it and to get better and research it better, which will be handy. So go to unsungpod.net/donate and name your price or prices. Mm-hmm. And as a result, you will get something like this. So the first of our two Split 7 inches tonight was suggested to us by, I think it was Ricky again, wasn't it?
Ricky Stuart. So he doesn't know it yet because it's not been out, but he suggested a topic for us, Split 7 inch, which we recorded recently, and he suggested more than one.
Yeah, Ricky actually put a few good ones in it in one thread, and it was like, I don't know what one to pick, so we're like, oh, this is a good opportunity to take another one. So.
Yeah, so not only is he getting private glory, but he's now getting public glory too.
Exactly. And other folks that have suggested them, we add them all to a big list and we do go back through them, and they will get pulled out of the hat at one point, much like the suggestions for the Nexus and the normal episodes. Please send us more of them. Got a couple of howlers this week, by the way, Mark. I'll tell you after we've recorded.
Oh, shit. Okay.
they're in the tub. Yeah, so we have been challenged to name the best three in a row.
The best trifecta.
Trifecta of good records by artists, what we like in it.
Yeah, that's not R. Kelly. There's no even one good R. Kelly album, frankly. But
R. Kelly's probably had three in a row of a lot of things.
Yeah.
Not good albums, though.
Yeah. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. It's going to be jail sentences soon, that's for sure.
No complaints here. So, Mark, did you have any that immediately jumped to mind?
Yeah, this has come up a few times in various different places. I think Video 6 did a suggestion on this like about a year ago on their Facebook page, and I think it's been in Kerrang and all that kind of shit. I'm pretty sure it's been a lot of places. So I did have one answer pre-ready for this.
Is it Prince?
It's not Prince. He is on the list though, but it's not Prince. It's Jimmy World.
Ah.
So Clarity and Bleed American, and then Futures, three really strong, really good records.
Is Futures good?
Futures is great, yeah.
I kind of got off the train after Bleed American. I mean, Bleed American is a great record, but I don't know why. There was just something, maybe it was their passage into like the mainstream, maybe they, I'm not sure, I just didn't feel compelled to revisit them after that.
So the lead single off of Futures was Work, which you may have heard, and it's kind of sunnier again than the middle.
That's probably why then.
But the album's got a lot of really dark songs on it as well.
The middle's pretty damn sunny.
I know. It just takes some time, little girl, in the middle of the ride. Everything, everything will be just fine. Everything, everything will be alright, alright. Hey, you know all it starts off with a song called Futures, which is about... It's a political song, more or less. And then it goes into some really dark territory. It's got a song called Kill, which has got a cracking chorus. Pain as well, which has also got a great chorus. I know, it's just like single words.
The only scary words that Jimmy World know.
And then Pain is followed by a song called Drugs Or Me, which is like this sort of slow, meditative, really airy, kind of sparse song about the end of a relationship because of drugs. And it has my favourite Jimmy World song on it called 23, which is 7 minutes long, and it's just unbelievable.
It's not as good as the song 23 by Blonde Redhead though.
Oh, I don't know about that. And then before Blade American, they had Clarity, which is like well known for being like the big breakthrough record to fans because it was like the first time people had ever really heard them properly in the mainstream. So I think the big song from that was pretty much Lucky Denver Mint. You might have heard.
Yeah, but it didn't break through the same way or in like the same way as the...
No, but this was like their first, this was like their major label debut almost. And it's got a lot, it's definitely much more albumy, if that makes sense.
Can you check I'm right, by the way, in the chronology? I'm pretty sure, did Bleed American come out in 2001?
It did, yeah, because
they had to change the name, didn't they? Because the single became Salt, Sweat, Sugar instead of Bleed American.
Because of 9/11, yeah.
Yeah.
Because I remember seeing...
That's a long time ago now.
Yeah, 18 years ago. Yeah.
The war's still going, that's right.
It's about to start again in the country next door. But no, Clarity is a lot more... it's definitely a lot more of a musical album, I would say. But fans fucking love that record. They toured 20 years of that a few years ago. And it's dynamite. It's probably a good album. And then Bleed American is Bleed American. It has singles on it. And it has lots of really great album tracks as well. And as I said, Futures.
Yeah, it's got praise chorus on it.
Yeah.
You can't really mess with it. Are you gonna waste your time? Gotta make a move or you'll miss out.
Someone's gonna ask you what it's all about. Stick around, nostalgia won't let you. It's got Cautioners, it's got Hear You Me, which is definitely overplayed now, I think. But it's still a lovely song, and Get It Faster. That's one of the things I found really interesting about that record is that's the first time I'd ever done anything which was kind of minor key, a lot darker sounding, a bit more grindy almost. Not grindy as in grindcore, but you know, like grungy.
Jimmy World's grindy.
Grungy, I guess. And then explore that a bit more on Futures.
That's like when you go into a restaurant and you ask for something spicy and it's literally got no spice in it whatsoever. You're like, yeah, this is our spicy. This has got the wee drawn of the chili next time. You're like, fuck off.
Yeah, exactly. I can't imagine. Do you know, it's interesting. I interviewed, Tom, the original singer of Jimmy World, who then went on to only do occasional vocals and is ostensibly the lead guitar player now. And he was talking about how he fucking loved death metal. He's a massive death metal fan. I tried to convince him to come back to Lewis's studio where we used to record our podcast to do some death metal jams, but he had to play a show that night in the Barris, sadly.
No, it's always getting in the road, isn't it?
Yeah, as I. But he was talking about like Enslaved and stuff like that and like proper death metal bands. I was like, fuck, this is so cool. So you should go check out that interview.
That's like, we never even mentioned it during the Weezer episode, but apparently Kerry King says the best shredder he's ever sat next to was Rivers Cuomo.
I can believe that, man. I can play.
Yeah, he said they were backstage at a festival and just all hanging out. And he said, and Rivers started shredding on this little amp. And he said it was jaw dropping how good he was. It's crazy, right?
What happens to that kid of talent? You just write pop songs? Like
so strange. I've got quite a few.
I have a few more, so.
A really obvious one for me because they were like my formative band. I liked a lot of music when I was younger. Big Cyndi Lauper fan. Big fan of like Scottish classic outfit called Big Country. I remember once for a school, I don't know what you'd call it, like open day thing. Mm-hmm. So every single kid in my school, apart from me, went to another high school. I was the only kid, and this tells you a lot about my personality, right? I was the only kid that went to the high school I went to from my primary, okay? But it meant that when they were all up visiting in the open day, their new school, I was just by myself in the school.
Just get the tiny violins out for this one, Chris.
I'll put in some like really sweet and sad music. So that day I got lumped in with the younger year groups, and it was the end of term, so everybody's doing their end of term games shit. And for the music class, they were like, okay, kids, everybody bring in a cassette of music you really like. And everybody was bringing in this like super wet, you know, well, at that point, late 80s music. I rocked up with a Slippery When Wet, which it turned out was too edgy. Too edgy for the primary six music class. Holy teachers shit. Gave me about half a tune.
Are you going to drop a Bon Jovi trifecta on us here?
I'm not. But after dabbling in that, the band that really set me off in a lot of ways was Nirvana. Mm. And I mean, more than just a trifecta, I think Nirvana, their four official releases during Kurt's lifetime were excellent. Even Incesticide, albeit it's a collection of B-sides and rarities, it's really, really good. Mm-hmm. And some of the tracks on it, Aneurysm, Dive, Molly's Lips, Son of a Gun.
Sliver's on that as well, right?
Sliver. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So many tracks in that are iconic Nirvana songs, so it's far from a throwaway issue. So starting with Bleach, which is a really great record, never mind obviously life-changing record for a lot of people, especially myself, Incesticide, and then In Utero, four fucking excellent albums. I'm not saying there aren't points on them that dip slightly, but overall absolutely legendary albums, and I think that's nothing to sniff at. So they're a really obvious one. Everybody's heard Nirvana, so I don't really want to spend too much time on them. A couple of ones that we've covered in the past, one that really stuck out was Converge. For me, Converge, going through Jane Doe. To You Fail Me, to No Heroes is really, really good. And I would add Axe to Fall as well for another four. So I love that album.
My favourite Converge album.
Yeah, I probably listen to that more than No Heroes, at least. So I think they also have a really, really strong period. They've had really good stuff since. People are kind of split on the last album a wee bit. But those records, it's a really, really strong run.
In the same category as that, I was thinking about Dillinger's Escape Plan, Calculating Infinity, Miss Machine, and Ironworks. I think that's a really good triumvirate. I think Ironworks is the record that got me into the band. Obviously, Greg came in and Miss Machine. There's a lot of really good songs in that too, and Calculating Infinity is Calculating Infinity, which is like a seminal record for that kind of music. Yeah, I think for me, they've struggled to make a bad record, but I know a lot of people disagree with that because a lot of people don't like the older, the newer stuff because it's a lot more straight-laced.
By a lot of people, do you mean me?
Most people.
I would be one of those people. I don't like a lot of Dillinger Escape Plan stuff. I think Calculating Infinity is stone cold killer. Definitely one day we'll be getting foisted forward into the discography. And I love Running Board EP and the Patton EP after it. I feel when Greg came in, they became a little bit of a sort of, I don't know, a little bit hipster, a little bit like Greg's style, that wannabe Patton thing. It didn't really work for you. Miss Machine I had. And yeah, there's a couple of good songs in it, but I'm not sure. I just don't think it's as special as the early stuff.
I think it's really interesting because having spoken to Ben on a number of occasions, he always says that the biggest thing for him and Dylan Just Escape Plan was to do the next thing which nobody expected them to do. And sometimes I meant going super poppy and doing something that was a bit different.
Apparently they spent $10,000 buying themselves onto the System of a Down tour and, yeah, and bankrupted themselves, but fortunately generated a whole bunch of interest off the back of it that allowed them to pay it back.
A calculated risk.
Yeah, buying onto tours.
I'm pretty sure every band you've loved done it.
No, I don't think that's the case, actually. I think it depends on the bands. Some bands are actually quite against it. I think, to their credit, as far as I'm aware, maybe not, it's not the case anymore because they're so big, but for a long time, Queens of Stone Age invited their guests on tour, and a lot of bands still maintain that. They invite the guests on tour rather than forcing them or forcing people to bid on it.
Yeah, I think you're right there.
Seems like a decent time, though, now that we're talking about moshing and riffs to cutting a wee bit of Dave Weaver.
He's just a fucking airdropped in his comment now. So.
Right. Okay, well, let's cut to that and then we'll see what we think.
All right, so 3 albums in a row by an artist who, and they're all fucking amazing. I mean, first of all, Korn did, their first 4 albums are fucking amazing. So Korn, that's in the bank. Deftones, I mean, first Deftones record is very good, but you'd have to say Around the Fur, White Pony, and then Deftones, that's 3 fucking 10 out of 10s right there. I mean, my god, doesn't get better than that. And then Saturday Night Wrist is a total shiter, to be honest. I mean, has Bjork ever done a shit album? Not really. I think her late 90s output is pretty much unbeatable. Yeah, let me have a further think. More coming.
I don't want to say too much because he's like not here.
Yeah, I mean, he's apparently jogging down the middle of a motorway from the sounds of that message.
I mean, Korn is like classically what is something.
Did you think for a minute David wasn't going to say Korn? Do you think for a minute a day goes by that David doesn't nominate Korn for something?
I can kind of see his point. I mean, if you've got like a nostalgic attachment to that kind of music, the first Korn album was a really good representation of new metal, and it was doing something that nobody was really doing at that time. Really, yeah. Weird sound.
I mean, I'm being wide, but actually the first 3, to be fair, all had a place in my heart. I don't go with them to number 4, but the first 3, yeah. Life is Peachy was still by far the best Korn album for me. I thought it was really, really good.
Issues was the one that I got into. I think I probably mentioned this on the new metal mixtape. So I think it's a decent record. Like, you know, when you get a record as a wee guy, right, and you're like so hyped up for it because you've heard a couple of the good songs. And you're like, fuck, I really want to hear that. And then you hear it and you're like, you're willing yourself to love it, but it's just not got the songs on it. I mean, you go, oh yes, it was totally that. Like, half good, half rubbish, but the rest pretty well. 4 the Leader's too long, I think.
Oh, it's too long, definitely. Yeah.
If you were to take away all the kind of filler, it would still be a cracking album.
Pretty ambitious. Yeah,
yeah, very ambitious, actually.
But at the same time, it is Korn, and their sheer fucking naffness overrules all that. On the other hand, Deftones is a really good shit.
Yeah.
That first record, even though it's got a dead weird recording, is still pretty great. I think that your mind is gone. You know, I have not been able to verify it, right, but I heard that that first Deftones record sat about for nearly 7 years before Maverick released it.
Really?
It may be bollocks, but I'm sure they'd recorded it and were pitching it and couldn't get anyone to put it out, and it was Maverick.
When did it come out? What year was it?
Can't remember. If that's total nonsense, then maybe I've just picked something up wrong.
But that would be late 80s, right, when they wrote that?
I don't know what year that was released. 96.
Yeah, so it would have been like It seems unlikely, to be honest.
Yeah, it does seem unlikely.
Sonically, anyway.
Maybe I'll cut that out of his bollocks.
You should definitely keep it in if it's bollocks. Because if it's true, then it means they're like a proper fucking progenitors of the metal.
I mean, you can't, around the first great, it's not my favourite Deftones record, but it was so significant at the time. But I mean, White Pony, man. White Pony is just one of the best records of the 90s.
In the early 2001 it came out.
Shit. Well, it's so good that it's still one of the best records of the 90s.
It is untouchable. Yeah, it's a gift that keeps on giving, I think.
Yeah, that's...
It still sounds fresh.
Even the secret track on that, is it the Boys... Boys... And I can't remember, something's... That secret track alone is just fantastic. Deftones had that weird thing where their secret tracks were extremely, extremely good as well. Have you ever got one of their collections of rarities and that, where all the secret tracks are grouped together, man? Mm. They're fantastic.
If we're talking about like new metal bands, right? Rage Against the Machine.
Rage Against the Machine is a really, really good show, because the first three records by Rage were tremendous.
And then Renegades is also great.
I think, is probably their best record. Mm-hmm.
Four albums in a row, which is are brilliant. I think this is probably controversial for some people, but I still think it sounds a bit timeless. I don't think they sound that dated sonically, maybe lyrically.
I think there's something to that. I think also because we've been doing Public Enemy, it really made me realise what an influence they took from hip hop, like classic hip hop, and you know, transcribing it for a live band. That really sunk in when I was listening to, you know, Fear of a Black Planet, and even like It Takes a Nation of Millions. Like, wow, these really, really were, you know, interpreting hip hop via live setup.
I think so. We'll definitely talk more about this when we do the Public Enemy episode. But I think it's worth probably saying at this point, like, even now, the Bomb Squad's production on some of those records is still like untouchable. Like, this sounds like nothing else.
Yeah, the beats are really explosive, especially.
Yeah, and you can totally see where they get that from. And Nine Inch Nails, like Trent Reznor's clearly a huge Bomb Squad fan, because his production technique is just as abrasive and loud, I think.
So that's a really good shout. Bjork, can't really mess with it. I suppose she's probably got a few in a row that are pretty strong.
That's not one that I feel qualified to really talk about, to be honest.
Yeah, despite us having done an episode, it's like cramming for an exam and it's all gone.
It's
now.
All gone, yeah. Honestly, sorry Dave, but I've not listened to Bjork since we did the episode. Sorry.
Cool, let's see what Dave's saying.
I think we might be talking about this soon, but Mastodon's first three records, in very different ways, are unbelievable records. Remission, just a statement of intent. We are going to be unrelentingly heavy. Then Leviathan, probably the best pure heavy metal album of the last 20 years. It's so gargantuan and full of incredible riffs, melodies, songs, just the most expansive metal record out there. And then Blood Mountain goes even madder, proggy, ridiculous, but still so, so good. Those three records are just fucking beyond a joke. I'd also maybe say Kendrick Lamar, Good Kid, Bad City, followed up by Pimp My Butterfly, followed up by fucking whatever that last one was he did. I can't even remember. But I mean, unbeatable there. But you know, I'll probably take Korn out of this actually, because that's four in a row that's good. That doesn't really count. And Issues is, you know, their best one. But yeah, that's Dave's thoughts.
At this point, I feel like Dave's giving his message from beyond the grave almost.
I keep wondering if we're going to hear a sudden like sound of a car horn and crashing metal, and then just it'll just be a long message of silence. Hang on, oh, you sent through it. I think that's a correction.
Damn! Kendrick Lamar. Good Kid, Bad City, then Kendrick Lamar, Pimp a Butterfly, and then Kendrick Lamar, Damn. Three total hip hop, modern hip hop classics. Fucking hell, what a boy.
Yes, David, Damn. That's correct.
Yeah, we were just saying that.
We were like mumbling that as you were trying to do it. World, that's Dave's thoughts from the M8.
Yeah, from the M8. The bypass, Kingston Bridge.
I don't listen to Kendrick Lamar, so I need to defer to you guys on that one.
I think he's incredibly overrated.
Uh-oh.
So let's move on.
We'll leave that one in Dave's lap then. And you don't need to deduct corn because it's four, David, that's fine.
We actually included them because it was four.
Mastodon, yeah, we are going to cover Mastodon soon. Mm. Spoiler alert. And the first two records are excellent. Blood Mountain I never really got into, but I think that's more a reflection of me, that when I've got a certain amount of metal that does a certain thing, I don't feel the need to keep buying it. Mm-hmm. And I think I felt like Mastodon started to repeat themselves, which I know they didn't, because I know they started getting proggier, but for whatever reason I just lost the appetite for them. Yeah, thanks Dave. Happy jogging. Well, hopefully cut back to you, can see you're recording more as we speak. Another couple that had kind of popped into my head. Silvermount Zion, I've mentioned before.
Yeah, you have.
Kind of the cousins of Godspeed You Black Emperor. Godspeed You Black Emperor are so good that they should probably be in here, but a bit like our friends, in my opinion, in Bad Religion, they keep doing this thing of doing two exceptional records and then one that doesn't quite land. There's a couple of bands actually that I think are quite guilty of that. They kind of sort of get most of the way there and then don't do it. Silvermount Zion, they had Born Into Trouble as the Sparks Fly Upwards is a truly amazing record that they did, but then they followed it up with This Is Our Punk Rock, which I think falls a bit short. Horses in the Sky is wonderful. 13 Blues for 13 Moons is wonderful. And then they fall short again in the release Collapse Traditionnel. And yeah, so I think there's a clutch of bands that are just about there. One that I would say is Interpol. The first Interpol album, Turn On The Bright Lights, is one of my favourite albums. And Antics is a stone cold classic record, classic indie rock record. It's way too late. Our Love to Admire, I think, is underrated, but only up until about track 6 or 7, and then it deteriorates towards the end, and it's a shame, because they're at about 2.5. If Our Love to Admire had a stronger ending, they would be a very, very strong 3, because the first 6 tracks in that record, at least, are excellent. Trail of Dead are probably a good shout. They've got a couple of strong runs, but again, they never quite, as I can see it, get to that equally strong third one. One that you may think controversial, Arcade Fire. Arcade Fire's first record is tremendous.
I don't like them at all.
Their first album, sorry, not the first record, because they had an EP before that. I know you're not a big fan. Funerals is just such a fucking great record. I really don't like Neon Bible. Neon Bible was a massive hit, did really well. Keep the Car Running was big breakthrough single for them in a lot of people's eyes. I just don't get it. And they did spawn a lot of these oversized 8 and 9 piece indie bands that just need to fuck off, especially when you're a sound engineer.
Yeah.
And you're just like trying to fit every, oh, how many channels? Oh my God.
Why have we got cello in this tiny venue?
Can you guys double up on that overhead? Oh no, you can't. Oh, what's that? You want your own monitor mix for the flute? Right, no problem. Hang on, I'll get another monitor brought from another city. Yeah, but then they followed that with The Suburbs, which is fucking brilliant. I love that album. If only Neon Bible had clicked with me. I mean, I'm not even going to say if only it was good, because I know so many people that like it, but if only it had clicked, I would have, they would have been a big three for me. What do you think about Green Day?
I don't, like, I know Green Day, I like Green Day, but...
No, I know that, but I don't mean like that, sorry, like, not the general sense.
But I'm not so familiar with their canon that I can really comment.
Right, so their pre-breakthrough album, Kerplunk, mm-hmm. well, actually, their first two EPs combined into 1039 smoothed out slap ears is really good, mm-hmm. but Kerplunk is a great album. Dookie is Dookie. Mm-hmm. Dookie is the, you know, one of the albums of the 1990s. And then Insomniac is a tremendous follow-up to Dookie. A lot more, I don't even know how to describe it. There's so much being said about it. Shifting away from just writing big pop singles and back to just writing really good pop punk. Mm-hmm. But those three records in a row, I think, are fucking brilliant. After that, Green Day begin their long, slow transition into farce bit by bit. I mean, they have great moments, but yeah, they don't ever come back from that.
I'm getting to be an old man now, and there are still moments on American Idiot which make me pump my fist in the air.
It's because you're an old man.
Yeah. Even now, and even that's with like the complete knowledge of the fact that it is all massively overplayed, all of it,
grotesquely so.
Yeah. One of the bands that I love, that I guess are more recent, are the Wonder Years, who are a six-piece pop punk band.
I'm not familiar at all, but what the fuck do six people do in a pop punk band? What, one sets up video games, the other one opens bags of Doritos while the four of them play?
How did you guess?
I'd even need four.
So they have three guitar players, but
who needs what?
Wait, let me finish.
What the fuck?
Let me finish. That's ridiculous. But a lot of the time, the third guitar player was playing keys. So it's only for when they want
keys and two guitars and bass and vocals, mm-hmm. and drums in, mm-hmm. a pop punk band.
Yeah,
that is overkill.
But there are bands which have definitely transitioned away from being. So they started off as being like a proper like post 2000s pop punk band. Their first record is so bad they don't even play it anymore. Their second album,
at least they're aware of it.
Yeah, they are going very, very aware of it. I think that there's a lot of clamouring for them to re-release it, and they did it like under extreme duress.
But I really,
like,
hope somebody actually
play this.
Somebody suggests this. I suppose I hope we do one eventually, which is bands that did an album that they disowned.
Yeah, we should definitely do that at some point. That'd be good. And then they did The Upsides, which is pretty decent, and then they did a trilogy of records, which is kind of, they're all thematically linked. First one's Suburbia, I've given you all and now I'm nothing. Which is actually based on Allen Ginsberg's poem America. Which is as wanky as it sounds, but it's a really good record. And then he followed up with The Greatest Generation and No Closer to Heaven, which are 3G records that are really, really good. And it sees them progressively moving away from being a pop punk band and kind of being more of a rock band, just a general straight up rock band. For me, that's a really strong... I mean, those three records are, like, neck and neck in terms of which one I think's the best. I don't think I'd actually choose one. They've all got strengths and weaknesses, which oddly complement each other. So they fill in the gaps of what was maybe missing from the record before can be found in the record afterwards. Also tour like fuck, man. Like they're on the road like all the time. I don't know how they find the time to write records because they're always touring. Yeah, that's one that popped into my mind right after Jimmy World. Again, in the punk vein, all the stuff that we've already covered, Against Me, the first three albums are really, really good. First four records are actually brilliant. It's a good four record run. POS, he's still punk in my eyes. Audition, Never Better, and We Don't Even Live Here.
Run the Jewels
as well, where that's what I was going on to next. Those are three absolute fucking classic records. Top tag team for two summers. Live and let live. Fuck you cuz that's a fool's honor. I'm walking toting on two llamas. You niggas. Given the amount of time they spent between writing those records, recording them, and how much they've been touring, it's staggering to think about they could be that productive, especially like when we said in the LP episode, particularly LP. Anyway, like he'd released four records in the past like 15 years before that, and then he'd released three and six and toured a fuckload with Killer Mike, you know. That's a really deep vein of creativity that they've kind of found there.
Yeah, I'm kind of fishing through some of the ones we've done. I think Tori Amos, she doesn't really tend to nail three in a row. Blonde Redhead have three great records, but again, I think they're not all back to back. And it's a tricky one. Well, Portishead, fucking hell, what am I talking about? Portishead's first three albums are
only three albums, yeah.
Outstanding, outstanding. Yeah, they'd be a really, really obvious choice. Actually, if I was thinking about it, other ones that Jesus Lizard. And the thing with Jesus Lizard is they've got five great records in a row. From, what is it, Goat? I'm trying to do it chronologically. Goat. Liar, Down, Shot, Ben Blue, the last two being on Capitol. The Jesus Lizard were fucking amazing, consistently amazing. Even the later stuff, like Blue gets a lot of sniffy looks. Shot got a few sniffy looks actually because it was on Capitol. Certainly Albini refused to work with them from that point, but Shot and Blue are both great records. Shot especially. Shot is outstandingly good. And for hit points, a go-to band for me, Electric, the French band. Their first record, Sad City's Hand Clappers, which is much more band-like, much more conventional. Mainly instrumental, quite experimental in places. Their second album, Discipline, which is their best, an absolutely astonishing achievement for an underground band. We will absolutely cover at some point. And then the third album, just, you know, Roman numerals 3, which is a really esoteric but incredibly rewarding record. Like, quite a hard listen at first. Especially for people that were familiar with Sad City's Hand Clappers, is it really very rarely kicks into anything like the riffs, or it's quite inaccessible. It's got a bit of a kiddie feel to it in that sense. It's like, what the fuck? These guys are really going off at an angle here. But the longer you listen to it, the more you get from it. And it's an overall experience as well. You can't really dip in and out of it. You have to put it on and get into it. But there's a lot in there, a lot of chewing, but it's really rewarding. So it kind of brought me down to two. it kind of left me with two. Do you have anything to add? Because I'm kind of torn between these two. I don't really know what one I prefer.
I have two to add, and one which we'll probably end on, because you know who it is. But this other one, Hatch has actually hit the six in a row, and it's The Boss.
No way.
Yeah, The Boss. Born to Run, Darkness on the Edge of Town, The River, Nebraska, Born in the USA, and Tunnel of Love. That's 10 years of just absolute fucking gold. That's...
I don't own any of them.
Unbelievable. Born to Run is...
How good can they be if I don't own them?
How many Bruce Springsteen records do you own?
Exactly, none. You listen, nobody rates Bruce Springsteen. Everybody just goes to those shows for a day out with their family.
I fucking love Bruce Springsteen. but, I mean, he just covers so much ground thematically, musically on those records. It's only when you kind of sit back and do something like this, you start to realise, hang on, those records are written like one after the other. That's a hugely impressive feat.
Mm. And certainly Nebraska stands out because I've spent more time with that one. At least for a little while, sir, me and her, we had some fun.
Nebraska is a phenomenal record. The one before that was The River, which is double disc, and he's definitely seen him move towards the Nebraska themes in that. And then Born in the USA, yeah, it's the big rock record, it's the big massive multi-platinum selling breakthrough album, but it does exactly what it's set to do, and it does exactly what it fucking says in the tin. Mm-hmm. It just has good rock songs.
Shout out from recent memory, 80s Matchbox, Bale and Disaster. Their three albums are really good. Mm. But the two that I got kind of caught up on, and I'll probably opt for this order, so second choice for me would be PJ Harvey.
Mm.
But the period, a lot of people would put probably Dry Rid of Me. I like that stuff, but it doesn't have nearly the yield that I get from To Bring You My Love, Is This Desire, and then Stories from the City, Stories from the Sea. To Bring You My Love is so odd as a record, especially coming off the back of Rid of Me, this kind of big Albini roomy rock record, this fucking stripped back music, really all about the dynamics, all about the performance. And then to go into To Bring You My Love, where it all becomes about the production and everything changes song to song, and some of it's really fucking weird. I lost my heart. Then Is This Desire and tracks like The River. I mean, it's a really, really esoteric, ambitious period of her career. She took a lot of chances because she was doing really well, rising, and then took this deviation where it became very artistically pure and sort of demanding of her audience, and it's fucking wonderful. And then the payoff at the back of that is that she brought out what's probably her overall strongest record in Stories from the City, Stories from the Sea. Speak to us, send us a sign, just give us something to keep us trying. Hustle is hard. Too many people. Multiple prize winning album, absolutely littered with great songs and great singles. I think those three records in a row are what set her up to be that sort of unimpeachably brilliant name in the sort of vein of Nick Cave, Tom Waits. You know, she's in with that kind of tier of musician now as a result of taking those chances. But my number one choice would be Fugazi.
Mm-hmm.
the last three Fugazi albums, Red Medicine, End Hits, and The Argument. Now, Fugazi's early catalogue is great, but Fugazi, again, started taking real chances from Red Medicine onwards for me. There were hints of it earlier on, but Red Medicine is just fucking brilliant. Followed it with End Hits, which is even more unusual and brilliantly realised. And then The Argument is just one of the best records I've ever owned. It's all the things that we're getting at in that, plus a bit of maturity and maybe a little bit of like older cynicism and, you know, dropping the pace a little bit at points. And I just think those three records in a row are as good as it gets, certainly for an alternative band.
Well, for me, it's Prince, obviously.
So oh, that's where we end. Cannot believe.
Cannot believe that was going to happen. Early to mid 80s, really, that's the thing. Like, Dirty Minds is a pretty good record. You're thinking this guy can write some good tunes, and you've got Controversy, 1999, and then Purple Rain.
Can we call it Controversy?
Controversy, if you want. Controversy. Yeah.
Controversy.
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 Yeah. And those are just, I mean, a lot of the cracking songs that he did have come from those albums, like Dirty Mind, When You Are Mine. Song Dirty Mind.
Oh, When You Were Mine. The Cyndi Lauper version of that song is the gush.
Uptown is on that, and Controversy's got Controversy. Do Me Baby, which is great too. I don't really need to say too much more. Mm-hmm. That song's brilliant. It's got a little red Corvette on it. It's got Delirious on it. It's got Something the Water Does Not Compute, International Lover, and then Purple Rain's Purple Rain.
International Lover. Fuck me, man.
He knew what he was doing, man. And then I suppose you could argue that there's like, he then came close to it a few times. You know, he had Parade and Sign of the Times in the late 80s. And then it was Love Sexy after that, which is not so good. And you had Diamonds and Pearls and Love Symbol, early 90s. Some of his newer stuff as well was pretty cool. I thought Hit and Run Phase 1, Phase 2, pretty interesting for what he did. Artificial Age, Pectum Electrum, you know, also kind of decent records. But the most frustrating thing about being a Prince fan is that he always knew it was there, that he could do it, and he just never did it ever again after the 80s, you know, like having like just a string of absolute like classic songs. He could never pull it together, which is,
he didn't need to though. I think as well, when you're that big, you can start to be complacent and take chances. And the problem is that unless you're, I'd say probably very lucky, a lot of those chances might still be artistically great, but just not click as a completely classic album.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the ones we're talking about take a lot of chances. The Godspeed stuff, Silver Mount Zion stuff, they take chances that are still at points wonderful, and maybe even at points as good as or better than some of the other points, but about consistency as a classic album, they're experimenting more, so the likelihood of getting to that number three is less, I would say.
I'm surprised no Dimension Mogwai.
Who? Mogwai. First two albums, I don't think. Yeah, 10 Rapid, no. Young Team, Cody, yes. then know. I mean, I'm not convinced. They've got so many good records and so many great moments. But again, I mean, it's no shame being in the same category as Interpol, Godspeed You Black Emperor, Arcade Fire, and, you know, Bad Religion, all these other great bands. They've taken some chances, and I don't think they've always necessarily panned out. By the way, that's just my opinion. A lot of people love things like Happy Songs and stuff, so I'm sure some people would say Mogwai have got 7 or 8 great records in a row.
Mm-hmm.
But they're wrong.
Okay.
All right, let's take a break, see what David's got to say, and we'll come back with part 2 of the 7-inch.